them.
Victorious Living Bible Institute Incorporated, an affiliate of Christian Bible Institute and Seminary, a non-denominational Bible institute founded as part of the Christian Education Department of the Upper Room Outreach Ministries Incorporated, based in Waycross, Georgia. VLBI has expanded now with an on-site campus in Kenya. Our mission is to equip men and women of God to be productive and functioning parts of the local body of Christ. VLBI provides affordable biblical education and leadership training for ministers, professionals, and laypersons. We will provide you with the skills, education, and character needed to effectively serve, equip, and shape the lives of others as they pursue excellence in Christian education, ministry, and leadership. Study on site at our Waycross campus or online in our Learning Center. Visit www.victoriouslbi.org. Call 1-833-884-8880.
Command your morning devotion and prayer live at 5 o'clock a.m. Monday through Friday at WHLJ 97.5 FM in Valdosta and Moultrie, Georgia. Also on Facebook Live on Mondays. You can also tune in by going to www.foxy97.com or call in to 67-807-9611, access code 266-590. Evangelist Renee Sellers is your host.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. This is Evangelist Renee Sellers of the Upper Room Outreach Ministries in Waycross, Georgia, where my pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III. And we are live at 5 this morning on this Faith Friday morning. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the weekend. Let us get ready. We're excited today to be coming to you live on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at foxy97.com. And you can join us on the conference call at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. After 6 o'clock, we go into discussion. We go into some feedback, may have some questions, but we also go into intercessory prayer for those that are on the call. So join us. Stay with us after 6 if you can, as we are getting ready to hear from a very special man and woman of God who are very special to the Upper Room Ministry. I'll tell you who they are in just a moment, but before we begin, I'm going to ask Lady Gospel Evangelist Paulette Griffin, all the way from Las Vegas, Nevada, to open our broadcast with a word of prayer. Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, we come giving you glory, praise, and honor for all that you've done in our lives and what you're yet to do. We thank you for the open heaven, the fresh anointing, for stirring up the very gifts in us, Lord God. As we come together from the north, the south, the east, and the west, together in your name, giving you glory and praise, thanking you for the open heaven. Thank you for the fresh anointing. Thank you right now, Lord God, for stirring up the very gifts in us, Lord God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Upper Room Outreach Ministries, Pastor Samuel, Evangelist Dr. Renee Sellers, for bringing forth Command Your Morning Prayer Line right here on Foxy 97.5 FM. We thank you for another opportunity, Lord God, to be able to learn more of your word, that your word may be planted upon good ground, to come up into fruition as you called it to be, Lord God. Heavenly Father, we ask that you open up the windows of our hearts right now, Lord God. Open up our ears to receive thy word this day. Thanking you right now, Lord God, for the open heaven and the fresh anointing. Thank you for each and every family represented upon the line, every ministry right now. As we come together, Lord God, glorifying and praising thy name. For thine, O Lord, you are the greatness and the power, the victory and the majesty, for all that is in heaven and earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. We know no other help but thee. We come thanking you right now, Lord God, for the open heaven and the fresh anointing. Thank you right now, Lord God, as you restore the virtue and the praise. Lord God, as the woman of God, bring forth thy word this day, Lord God. We thank you that it may be planted upon good ground, Lord God, and come up in fruition as you called it to be. We've just come to give you glory and praise for all that you've done and how you've kept us throughout this week and how you're still yet providing and meeting our needs. We thank you for all things. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, woman of God. In the matchless name of Jesus, for there is no other name like the name of Jesus. And as we shared on yesterday, Jesus said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repentance is the only way to gain access unto the kingdom of God. I'm excited right today for kingdom, this kingdom man and woman, these kingdom ambassadors this morning, as they get ready to share with us on today. Our special guests is a man and a woman that they're very special to Pastor Sellers and I. Pastor Sellers looks at this man of God as his mentor. He really looks up to him. He really follows his leading, as the Bible tells us, to be imitators of God, following the example of Christ. As Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. And so thereby we are thankful today to have people in our lives of which we can look to as role models for us. So his name is Elder Nathaniel Anderson, and his wife, you heard her voice on our radio broadcast doing opening prayer, or after we went off the air, Lady or Minister Emily Anderson. They stem from the great metropolis of Blackshear, Georgia, and their ministry is in an even larger metropolis of Bristol, Georgia. Thank you for coming from Bristol, Evergreen Church Ministries Incorporated in Bristol, Georgia. He's been the kingdom-minded visionary pastor of this of this ministry for 24 years, and they have a beautiful motto, which I've heard: if the church is alive, it's worth the drive. And I'm excited today because Pastor Anderson believes that people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge from Hosea 4:6. He is a passionate, anointed teacher and student of the word. Armed with God-inspired vision, he takes this motto of people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge beyond the walls of the church. And this is so true. He takes this motto beyond the walls of the church, becoming an effective agent of positive change in Pierce County, Ware County, Bacon County, Jessup, Georgia, Wayne County, leading, and other counties, surrounding counties, leading by example. Pastor Anderson is a man of integrity in the church community and personal life. He accepted Jesus as Lord of his life on Sunday, May 13th, 1973, nurtured by the late Senior Bishop H.J. Eccles of Firstborn Church of the Living God in Waycross, Georgia. He became an active and faithful member of Sunday School, YPCW, Adult Choir, and Home Mission and Outreach Ministry. After years of faithful service, he was ordained a deacon. He and his family served at Firstborn for 13 years. In 1986, Deacon Anderson led his family to faith of God. I want to stick a pin in that part of his bio. This is the first part. I want to stick a pin in where it says he led his family to faith of God. Under the teaching and example of Bishop Larry Atkinson, he began to mature spiritually. While at Faith of God, he continued to serve faithfully as an adult choir member, amen, a singer in the room, and initiated a men's ministry. In 1993, he submitted to the call to preach the gospel. He became pastor of Evergreen Church in 1995. He soon became the best pastor we know. He is an anointed teacher of the Word of God who is always pursuing knowledge to empower the people of God. He was born in Bristol, Mershon, Georgia, and is a native of Pierce County. And so Pastor Anderson received his Bachelor of Theology from Christian Life School of Theology. While pursuing his bachelor's degree, he founded another ministry, Boys to Men Incorporated, a nonprofit civic organization for youth ages 8 to 18. He currently serves as president executive director, working from the principle, good information leads to good decisions. I want us to stick a pin in that as well. Good information leads to good decisions. Going back to his initial aspect, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, because you cannot make a conscious decision with limited information. Also under that umbrella, they started, he and his wife, Swans, a separate gender organization created to expose the youth in the community to new ideas. This Swans is for young girls. So he's very active in his community, serves on many civic organizations, has received many community awards. But what I believe one of the things that he's most excited about is being married to the love of his life. his lifelong Valentine of 51 years, and she's probably shouting right now, Minister Emily M. Anderson. They have been blessed with 5 children plus 3 by marriage and 2 declared children, along with 9 grandchildren. So this morning we are excited to have, and Minister Anderson has joined us at Victorious Living Bible Institute, teaching in our leadership training. So he is an awesome leader, an awesome teacher and trainer. And we're excited today for those that have been in our classes. You were in our class, and I've heard people say, I love Pastor Anderson's teaching. So for those that love Pastor Anderson's teaching, he is back, ladies and gentlemen. So good morning, Pastor Nathaniel Anderson, all the way from Black Chair, Bristol, Waycross. Good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Evangelist. I am excited about being here, and I do thank God for you and Pastor Sellers, the great work you are doing in the community. The community is better because of the two of you, and so I just thank God for what you're doing, and I really enjoy the command your morning messages that you've been bringing. I've been watching some of them. I'm not an early morning person like my wife, so I mostly catch it on the second, on the rebound, on Facebook and things like that. But I enjoy your message. I enjoy your gift to the body of Christ, and I'm just glad to be here this morning.
And we're so glad to have you, and it's an honor to hear that from someone who has been in ministry all these years and is such a skilled man of God and so skilled in the Word. So that is an honor coming from you, and we give God all the glory. I also want to introduce your wife, your Valentine, your lifelong Valentine, Lady Emily Anderson, this morning, because the two of you are going to be sharing with us together. Good morning, Minister Anderson.
Good morning, Evangelist Sellers. It is so great to be with you all once again.
Thank you so much. It is an honor, woman of God. It is such an honor to have you both. Now, I said as I read your bio, I saw where it says that Deacon Anderson, now Pastor Anderson, led his family to faith of God. I want to talk about that word led from a father or a man of God's perspective, because we had the opportunity to go over to Brunswick yesterday, and it was an amazing opportunity. It was an amazing time to pray with faith leaders from all cultures, all ethnicities, different faiths, all came together. And I was reminded of John 17, where Jesus prayed that we be one. But also later on that night, one of the leaders that orchestrated this event shared while they were commending mothers, he talked about the importance of fathers leading. And I want to just ask you to share with us this morning why leading your family is so important today.
God has called a man to be the high priest in his home, and he's also called him to be the king. And so being king does not mean dominating, but we're supposed to be the example for our family. We're supposed to protect our family spiritually, financially, provide for them. We're supposed to do all these things and choose the direction in which our family go. But I want to commend that I thank the Lord for my wife being the kind of a woman that is not that hard to lead. She listened to God, and then she knew that I'm following God, so then she followed me. And so we just thank the Lord for being under good ministries. Bishop Eccles was an outstanding man of God. He was a man of faith. And after he died, we got acquainted with Bishop Larry Atkinson, and he's also a mighty man of God. And I was hungry. I mean, I was saved, but at one point I had got stagnant, and I wasn't growing. And then Bishop Atkinson came into our life. I became familiar with him, and I just became addicted to his teaching, to the word of God that was coming forth from him and the lifestyle that he was living. And so my wife and I, we visited that ministry several times, and we both felt led to go over there. So it was not a hard decision. But I thank the Lord for my wife being the kind of a woman that when we could come together and make a choice, and then our church didn't have any voice in the matter. They had to go where we went. So it was not a difficult thing. And we were following our hunger. we had a hunger for God and for the things of God. And so we were going where we could get fed. So that's why we ended up at Faith of God. And then the Lord led us over into Bristol to become the pastor at Evergreen Church in Bristol. And we've been there for 26 years, and God has really blessed us over there. And so we give all the glory to God for what he has done and what he is doing in our lives. Without God, we just couldn't do it. Without God, the things that he has accomplished through us would not have been done. But it's good to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. So that's what I try to do, is be sensitive to the Spirit of God, because the Spirit of God will give you directions in what you need to do. That way you won't get tied up in your emotions and tied up in your own personal opinion and your own agenda, because you're listening to God. So when you let God lead you, it's not that difficult for you to lead other people.
When you let God lead you, it's not that difficult to lead other people. And that takes us back to Matthew chapter 4, because the Bible says that Jesus, after his baptism, was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he endured, overcame, had the victory, was able to withstand the weight of the temptation because he stood. He did not yield to it. And I said yesterday that Jesus would have aborted his assignment had he yielded to temptation. Now, he was led up by the Spirit to be tempted, but he prevailed. Why is that important? As you shared in your biography, one thing that enables us to endure is to get knowledge of God and knowledge of the Word. And you said recite the Hosea 4 and 6, people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Why is it important that people know God and know the Word of God?
God is our creator. God knows what we need, and he knows how to get to us what we need. People are striving for many different things. But and God wants us to have things. But if we get things out of order, if we don't get it the way God provides for us to get it, it's not going to last long, and it's not going to have a positive effect. But if you follow the direction that God gives you, and God gives us direction in his word, there are three ways that God communicates to us. And one is through the Bible, which is the word of God. The other way, another way, is through the church, because he said, upon this rock I'll build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And he gives us each other. He gives us ministries in the body of Christ. And I think about over in the scripture, we're talking about how Josiah, whenever God delivered him, he said, listen to your prophets, because God will direct through the prophets. So sometimes God doesn't directly speak to you. He speaks to me through you, the wonderful words that you've been bringing. And so we're stronger together. So God speaks to us through the Bible. He speaks to us through the Word of God. He speaks to us through ministers of the ministry, the church, and he speaks to us by his Holy Spirit. And so when we become acquainted to God in all three areas of those, you know, the Spirit, the church, and the Word of God, then we have a lot of information that's coming forth, because God means for us to be victorious in every area of our life. At Evergreen Church, the primary target, a primary goal that we look at is having mature Christians that will follow the commission given by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we focus on maturity. I don't believe that it's God's will for Christians to always be whining and complaining about how bad life is and how bad the devil is, because the devil is no competition for you whenever you are following the Holy Spirit, whenever you have God in your life. I don't give him no credit for anything. The only thing he can do in our lives is what we allow him to do. The Bible says give no place to the devil. And when we give place to the devil and the devil bring in destruction, then we start complaining, but it's because we gave place to the devil. And I realize that many things happen, whether you're saved or unsaved, you're going to have some bad things that happen in your life, some good things that happen in your life, but God always gives us an avenue if we just follow his Spirit, follow his prophet, follow his word, and that way we will always be overcomers. And so I thank the Lord for that. We teach victory. That's my goal. And I thank the Lord for your ministry, Victorious Christian Living, because that's right in agreement with what we're doing. And so I just don't believe in Christians always whining and complaining. Get up from there, find out what the problem is, find out the solution to the problem, and go on about your life. And don't let the devil hold you back or hinder you or stop you, because there is victory in your path if you just go. It's already prepared. It's a fixed fight. We already are conquerors. We are already more than conquerors. We are winners, and we are warriors, and we are fighters. And all we have to do is just get in line with God's word, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, and if we do those things, then we'll have victory in every area. You're going to have some down times, but you have to realize that the down times is just an opportunity for you to go up higher. So I just believe in victory, and I believe that the more we know about the word of God, the more we'll be equipped to fight the good fight of faith. And I believe the good fight is the fight when we win. So I believe in the knowledge. The Bible says, without knowledge, my people are destroyed. Oh, in Isaiah, it said, my people are led into destruction, into captivity, because they have no knowledge. So I'm big on learning. I'm big on applying what you learn. And when you do that, you have a victorious life. You won't always be, the devil won't always be behind you. I mean, he won't always be chasing you. He won't always be destroying your life. He won't be bringing destruction in every area when you know how to fight the good fight of faith. And faith is always based upon what you know. You cannot have faith for anything that you don't know. So you have to get knowledge. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, which means you hear the word of God. And after you hear the word of God, faith is in the word of God. So when faith is in the word of God, you have to let that faith that's in the word of God get into your spirit, get into you. And when that faith gets into you, then you'll be able to conquer, you'll be able to fight, because God has already given us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. So I'm big on knowledge. I'm big on getting to know, because not without knowledge is destruction, and with knowledge is victory.
Wow, thank you so much for that, because it is vital that people allow themselves to be taught, because teaching keeps us grounded. The teacher,
that's right.
The teacher, the fivefold ministry leadership gift of the teacher keeps us grounded. And you talked about being mature Christians, which that is the responsibility of the fivefold ministry leadership gifts in Ephesians 4, is to help believers get to a place of maturity. And you said regarding boys to men, and we're going to talk about boys to men, you said working from the principle, or your bio says working from the principle, good information leads to good decisions. I would like for you and Lady Anderson to tell us about boys to men and swans, and where, with everything that's going on now with the pandemic and the things that people are not gathering the way they were before March 2020. Tell us about Boys to Men, the purpose, Boys to Men and Swans, and where you are now with that ministry.
Okay, well, Boys to Men began with, in our ministry, we have a lot of young people. And I would see a lot of young boys coming, but there were not a lot of men coming. And they were coming with women. And I may be wrong about this, but I don't believe that a woman can teach a boy how to be a man. And so they needed male influence in their lives. And in our church, we had a ministry called Men to Men. And so when we got ready to, my concern about the boys, we named it Boys to Men. But when I was about to get ready to start it in church, God spoke to my heart and let me know that the ministry was needed beyond the four walls of Evergreen Church. So what I did was I contacted other ministers and other ministries and other people that God laid on my heart. And we formed an organization, and we set it up and formed the 541K, and not 401K, the 501C3, and the nonprofit organization status. And we set it up. We laid the groundwork for it. And so what happened was we got it where it was in the community, not just Evergreen Church. And I saw the need, because in our society, in the black community, 70% of our households are one-parent households. And usually the one that in the household is the woman. So our young men needed some positive male role models. And every time that there's a man in the home, it doesn't necessarily mean that he's a positive role model. And black men make up 4% of the entire population in the United States. But we make up around 65 to 70% of the prison population. So a lot of our young boys were headed in that direction. And we formed Boys and Men to help do what we could. I mean, it's better to just light a match than to curse the darkness. And so we knew that Boys and Men was not an organization that could take the place of the father in the home, but it was something that was, it was a light. And so the Boys and Men gathered, we had about 60 boys that were a part of the program. And we were picking up boys from Waycross, Blackshear, well, we're from Pierce County, from Bacon County, from Wayne County. And we would bring them over to a neutral place over at the Newton Center in Patterson. And we would do workshops. We would have somebody like Pastor Sellers, somebody that was that grew up, a black man that was a positive role model, somebody that made it through, didn't use an excuse for not having a father in the home, or a good father in the home, but they succeeded. And so we would have people to come in. We had people from prisons. We had lawyers, doctors. We had people from all walks of life to come in and give these young men inspiration. And when the pandemic hit, we had to discontinue having meetings because of the safety. I didn't want to take a chance on any of the boys contacting the virus, and there was no way that we could do social distancing, because we would carry them to the center, we would feed them a lunch, we had a game room where they could shoot pool, play ping pong, and different things like that, and outside they could play basketball. See, they were coming for the fun, but we gave them good information before they got the food and the fun. And so boys began to tell other boys, and it just began to grow. And we are well pleased at what God was doing. We give God all the glory. We had support from different people in the community that helped us, because we started with nothing. And I realized that sometimes God don't give you anything but a vision. And when God gives you a vision, he'll make provision. But you first, you got to start moving with the vision. You have to start moving with what you have. And then if you're moving with what you have, then God will bless as you go. And I was thinking about the scripture where Moses was leading the children of Israel out of Egypt, and they had the army behind them, and they had the Red Sea in front of them, and they didn't know what to do. And I think I heard you speak on this, where God just told Moses to take the rod that he had in his hand and lift it up. And when he lifted his hand, when he lifted the rod up, then the sea, the Red Sea began to divide. It didn't happen until he did what God commanded him to do. And I think about the children of Israel whenever they got ready to go over to the Promised Land, and Jordan was there. The Jordan did not roll back until the priests put their feet in the water. And once the priests put their feet in the water, then Jordan rolled back. In other words, God would give us an assignment, but God works with us according to our faith and obedience. When we're faithful and obedient to the things of God, we don't have to have the answer. We don't have to have finishing grace. We just have to have starting grace. And we don't have to have finishing information. We just have to have starting information. Start with what you already have. And when you start with what you already have, if you'll do that, you're obedient in what you know, then God will continue to give you what you don't know. So it's a faith walk. And it all goes back to having proper knowledge of the Word of God, sensitive to the Holy Spirit, and being able to listen to other people. Because it's a lot easier to do something when you find somebody's already done what you've done. When you find somebody's already done what you're trying to do, they can help you avoid a lot of knocks, a lot of unnecessary work. And so God has a plan, and if we follow God's plan, then God will accomplish what he said he was going to accomplish through us. But we have to start with the information that we have. And it all goes back to information. Ignorance is not our friend.
Wow. Ignorance. Somebody needs to write that down, put it on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, well, whatever, TikTok, that ignorance, and make it personal, ignorance is not my friend. Pastor Lady Anderson, we're going to take a quick break for station ID. I'm excited this morning on this Faith Friday. We are live at 5 this morning with your Command Your Morning broadcast with our special guest, Pastor Nathaniel Anderson and Minister Emily Anderson from Blackshear, Bristol, Georgia, Evergreen Church Ministries. We're live today on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can join us online this morning at FoxyFOXY97.com, and you can join us on the conference call at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. If you're listening, you're enjoying this morning, I need you to wake somebody up. I need you to call your neighbor, text your friend, wake your husband or wife up if they're still sleeping, and tell them to join us for Command Your Morning. We have just about 28 minutes left on our broadcast. I want to bring Minister Anderson on this morning, and I like what you said, and I understand why my husband is so drawn to and sees you as a mentor. You talked about vision, and you said move with what you have, then God will bless where you go. And sometimes we may not see the end result, but God knows what the end is going to be. Move. This is something else you might want to write down for you visionaries. Move with what you have, then God will bless where you go. One thing about my husband, and I believe why he's been so successful, is because he moves with what he has. And sometimes I go to his shop and I'm like, where did he get all this equipment, these tools? He doesn't change tires. He don't change anybody's oil, but he moved with what he has. And I'm just amazed sometimes at God. And sometimes people get impatient or frustrated because they don't understand that not everybody is going to move the same way. Not everybody is going to move the same way. But I want to bring on Minister Anderson for just a few moments, because one thing that I love is the love that you have for your wife. That's one thing that really encourages me, is the love, the honor that you have for your wife. And you talked about her as part of the ministry. You wanted her on to share because she's a great part and a great asset. She complements your ministry. And Lady Anderson, I want to talk about that for wives this morning. God bless you, woman of God, and thank you for being on. You're already on, but thank you so much. I want to talk about Proverbs 14:1 for really quick, because it says that every wise woman builds her house, but the foolish pluck it down with her hands. I want to read through verse 4, or at least verse 3. And it says, he that walketh in his uprightness fears the Lord, but he that is perverse in his ways despises him. In the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride, but the lips of the wise shall preserve them. Woman of God, tell us about your ministry to your husband this morning. God bless you.
God bless you. Thank God for being here. It is easy for me to follow the man of God because of following Christ. It is easy for me to walk in submission because I realize that when I was decided to do that and really realized that I walk in submission with my husband is because I please God. And that's my desire, to please him, to honor him in our marriage. That's part of what I do. It is an easy assignment for me once I realize that I please God. When I choose to walk in submission, when I choose to yield, when there are times when someone needs to step back, well, that's my role. And I step back because I want to please God. I remember one Sunday morning, God dropped this in my spirit, that your best chance of recovery is to stick with God. So no matter what it is, I realize that I am to honor God and to honor my husband when I walk in submission to God's will for my life. Now, I walk in submission because he never asked me to do anything outside of the Word of God.
When and that's a blessing boys, because...
Okay, yeah. When we started Boys
Go
Den,
ahead, Pastor.
After, I don't know, after about 5 or 6 years, I have a granddaughter, and she was about 5 years old. And she said, Granddaddy, when you going to start a Girls to Men? And so that sounded kind of funny, Girls to Men. But I knew what she meant. And my wife is a good example. My wife is a smart woman. I mean, she's just smart. She's intelligent. And I use that intellect. I don't try to put her in a basket or try to put her behind me or anything because I take advantage of what God has put in her and her knowledge that she has. And so there's a lot of areas where I know she's smarter than I am. And so what I do is I just use her wisdom and use her her knowledge and her information and her input that she gives to me because as far as I'm concerned, it's not about who gets the credit. It's about getting the job done. And so somebody else can get the credit. I don't care about the credit. I mean, I know that when you do something, God's going to give you credit. People are going to give you credit. But you always point it back to God and give God the glory. So she is such a smart lady, and she's intelligent, and she can hear, she can listen to God, and she's a person of details. God can show me what needs to be done, and I can take that to her as a headline. And then she'll help add in all the information that need to be done. We'll get together and we'll talk about it and we'll discuss and then we go to work. So she's just I can't describe how much of a blessing she is to me in the ministry and in my life. And so I just value her so much. And I just wanted to add that up and say it so everybody know it.
To God be the glory. Thank you so much for that because. As someone, you said she's a smart woman. And Lady Anderson, there are times when sometimes there may be one, and I'm not saying that in you all's case, I'm just saying that because it is the case with some couples. There may be one with a little more education than the other, a little more knowledge than the other, and sometimes that will be used as a way of undermining or minimizing the value of the other spouse or what they have to offer. Tell us about that because the Bible lets us know that a soft answer turns away wrath. Tell us about that. And before you do that, I want to read for the hearing of those in the audience, Colossians chapter 3 and verse 18 from the Amplified Bible. And it says, wives, be subject to your husbands out of respect for their position as protector and their accountability to God. And so sometimes we neglect to honor or submit because we look at the person and personality and not their position. And as I prepare for meetings, I write myself a note, focus on the issues and not personality. And it says, out of respect for their position as protector and their accountability to God, as is proper and fitting in the Lord. Tell us about that soft answer. Why is that important for us?
It is important to us, number one, because it is the Word of God. And a soft answer, what it will do if something is about to burst forth, then the soft answer will cause it to, I think the right word probably is de-escalate. It, when we return with a soft answer. But with that said, that does not come automatically. You have to position yourself so that you will be able to receive the Word of God.
so that when the opportunity comes up, you would choose a soft answer. That's not our nature by default. Our nature by default is that, oh, no, I've got to protect me. You're not going to say that to me. But if when we make the choice to please God and we have to practice, hear me good, we have to practice giving a soft answer. You have to decide that God will take care of me. I am going, God will fight my battle for me. What I need to do, I need to realize that I need to do what the Word has called me to do. So I pray for the other person because it is going to benefit the whole. It benefits the atmosphere in the household. So on purpose, you have to choose to give a soft answer. Many times, because we are female and because of our ethnicity, we can come back pretty quick with something. And most of the time, it is not godly. So on purpose, we have to put time in wherein we practice saying those things, giving those responses that are in line with the Word of God. Just like we on purpose go to get our hair done. Well, I do. We go to get our hair done and we get our nails done. We do that on purpose because we want a certain outcome. The same way it is with your marriage and your home. On purpose, you have to practice the Word of God. And you cannot be so concerned about you, but it's about the unity that God honors in a home, and that is the unity of marriage, which operates and off of godly principle.
Amen. Thank you so much. That we have to choose, we have to practice, we have to put the Word into practice, in other words. And I thank you for sharing that, because we have to also remind one another that everything we do, from how we treat our spouse to how we treat people in the community, it all goes back to God. It's all unto Him. When Paul was going, Apostle Paul, before he was Apostle Paul, was going to persecute Christians, Jesus called out, "Why do you persecute me?" And so everything we do is unto God. And I want to read James 1:25, and I'm going to let Pastor Anderson give us about 10 minutes of encouragement as we get ready to close. But James chapter 1 and verse 25, the Living Bible says, "But if anyone keeps looking steadfastly into God's law for free men, he will not only remember it, but he will do what it says. And God will greatly bless him in everything he does." I'm going to turn over to Pastor Anderson for the next 10 minutes. We're going to hear a word of encouragement for him. Thank you so much, Pastor and Lady Anderson, for your encouragement, for your knowledge, sharing your knowledge of the Word of God and your experience in ministry and life as a married couple in ministry. Share with us this morning, Pastor Anderson, a word of encouragement for the next 10 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, Pastor Nathaniel Anderson, Evergreen Church Ministries, Bristol, Georgia.
Thank you so very much. I remember when I talked to Evangelist Sellers before, and she asked me to maybe say something that will encourage ministers and pastors, because due to this pandemic and different things going on, some ministries have even closed their doors, and a lot of pastors have gotten discouraged. And so what I want to speak directly to them, and I want to use the book of Joshua, chapter number 1, and I'm going to begin looking at verse number 2. It says, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give them, even the children of Israel." Now, I want to touch a little bit about, he said, "Moses, my servant, is dead." And as a minister, as a pastor, I think we can use Moses as an example. Moses was a godly man. Moses was a friend of God. But Moses had an anger issue. And Moses allowed his anger, he allowed the people that he was going to deliver into the promised land, to cause him to get frustrated and angry, and some of them went over, but he didn't go over because he allowed his anger to cause him to disobey God. And so I want to say that when you are pastoring, when you're ministering, always be sensitive to the Spirit of God. And people will become contrarian. People will become, they'll want to attack you like they did David. David saved these people, and they gathered around him. But whenever the enemy came in and took the family, they wanted to stone David. So sometimes the very people that you're trying to help will turn against you. But when they do, you need to be able to encourage yourself, or God will send somebody to you to encourage you. I remember when we were in the process of building Evergreen Church, and I knew that God had given me the vision. He gave me the vision for, he wanted to build told me to build a sanctuary for 500 plus people. And the church at that time only had about 11 people and 11 adults. And I could not tell those people that God said to build a sanctuary for 500. And I began to question God myself. And I said, well, Lord, there's not 500 people in Bristol. I heard sisters called the great metropolis, but it's a metropolis, all right. But it's not that big. I think the population in Bristol altogether might not be but about 500 or 600 people. But God told me that he was going to send people from 12 different towns within a 30-mile radius of the building where we were. And so he told me to build a building because they were going to come. And so I listened to God. But when you listen to God, when you transition, as Sister Sellers was talking about during the week, whenever Jesus transitioned and went into his public ministry, there's going to be temptations, there's going to be trials, there's going to be tests, there's going to be obstacles that's going to come in your way. And so we didn't have the funds to do what we were going to do, but the Lord gave it to me to do it in sections, in portions, and so in different phases. And so the first phase that we were going to do was to build up, to repair what we already had and add a little bit on to it. And we went to the bank, and I have good credit. My credit score, the last time I checked, was like 815. And that's because I pay my bills. And if you got good reputation, you can get some money. And so they loaned me the money on my credibility. And they gave us 15 years to pay it back. Well, we used the money and built the part that we were going to do, which was added on repair our sanctuary and add on the fellowship hall. And the 15-year mortgage was paid off in 3 years. So we got excited about what God was going to do, and the people got excited. So now I could tell them we're going to build a new sanctuary. But when we started building the sanctuary, I thought it was going to go off like it did when we first built the other part, the fellowship hall. But when we built the sanctuary, first of all, we had a hard time getting a contractor. And when we finally got a contractor, he was a novice, and he was experimenting on us. And so we ran out of money when we got the foundation built. So all we had out there was a foundation and no money. And the foundation laid flat, laid bare for 4 years. And we already had maxed out our loan. And so it took us 4 years to pay off the loan that we had. And during that time, I was getting discouraged. And I didn't tell anybody I was getting discouraged, but the people seemed to be still encouraged, you know, all during the time. And the foundation began to fall apart. I mean, the concrete began to cave in and separate from the wall. And so when we did get ready to build, we had to redo the structure. But my point was this, that during the 4 years when nothing was going on, I began to get kind of discouraged. So sometimes it looked like God is not doing anything, and it's going to be like that. But even when it looked like God is not doing anything, God is doing something. And sometimes he's preparing you instead of preparing what you're going through. And so you have to be prepared. But I got discouraged, and I began to think, I said, well, maybe God is going to use me to do like a marathon, like a, what's called it, whenever you have a relay. So maybe God is going to use me to be the relay person, to start the first person, and then somebody else come behind me and finish, because it was a big project. It was about like a $1 million project. And so we didn't have any money. But then God sent a minister to me, I wrote his name down there. But anyway, I had not seen the minister in probably about 4 or 5 years. And he came up to me at a banquet and told me, God told me to tell you that you will finish this project. You will build this building. You will be the one to do it. And that man, I had not told anybody. I had even told my wife. But God sent him to me to encourage me. And so I was encouraged. And I'm hoping that if you're whatever you're going through right now during this pandemic, don't give up. Sometimes you don't understand what God is doing, but even when he's not doing something, he's doing something. Even when it looked like God doesn't care, he cares. So all we have to do is hold on, be faithful unto the end. The thing is to know that God gave you the vision. If you know that God gave you the vision, then have confidence in God to fulfill the vision. So I'm saying this to try to encourage anybody that's going through right now, through these times, to know that God will bring you through. God is faithful. I tell the people at Evergreen that there are two things, two statements that keep me holding on no matter what. And one of them is God is good. I know that bad things happen. Bad things happen to good people. But see, what we have to realize is we have an enemy. See, Satan has authority in the earth. The earth does not belong to him, but he's got a temporary lease on it because of Adam. See, God put the earth into the hands of man. And when God put the earth in the hands of man and man abandoned God, Satan got control. That's why the Bible calls Satan the god of this world. See, Satan, there are things that Satan can do. And so what I am amazed about is how so many people, when bad things happen, they say God did it. When God had nothing to do with it, you got an enemy. And many times the things that happen to us, we don't want to admit it. It's because we sowed bad seed and now we're receiving the harvest from the seed that we sowed. But I don't blame God because the Bible says I've never blamed God for any bad thing that's happened into my life because I know that God is good. And the Bible says every good and perfect thing comes from God. So that holds me. That holds me steadfast. And the other thing that holds me steadfast is I know that God is faithful. God, the Bible said that Abraham was fully persuaded that whatever God had promised, he was also able to perform. And so that's what we have to do, and that's great faith. And so what we have to do is continue to hold on our faith to God, not based upon what it looked like, for we walk by faith and not by sight, because sight will deceive you. Sight will make you think you are defeated when it's only a setback for a short time. So be to the point where you trust God no matter what happens, because God is faithful. And so those two things hold me up. God is good, and when bad things happen, I don't ever blame God because I know God is good. And I know that there are things that God could prevent, he could stop if he wanted to, but God has given all of us free will. And sometimes another person's free will can violate you because the people that you are attached to, a lot of time will have a lot to do with the consequences that happen into your life. That's why you have to be careful who you attach yourself to. So there are consequences. But God is not the author of it. And so, and anything that we get into, whether it's the enemy's fault or whether it's our fault, the statement that my wife made that God gave her one day while we were in Sunday school class, and that is that God is always your best chance of recovery. No matter what you're going through, if it's your fault, stay with God because God will help you to get over it. If it's the enemy's fault, stay with God because God is your best chance to recover. So stay with God. And don't ever blame God for the negative things that happen because bad things happen to good people. We live in a fallen world. And so Satan has a temporary lease, and he's out to steal, kill, and destroy. But always hold on to God. And then sometimes we don't understand why God allows us to go through what we go through. But we have to trust him when we don't know him, when we don't see him. I believe it was Job that says, I'm kind of paraphrasing, Job says, I look to my right hand, I look to my left hand, all behind me, all around me, and I can't see God. I don't know what he's doing. Then he says, but he know the path that I take. So we have to have confidence in God, that God know what we can handle, and God know what we can't handle. The Bible says he will not allow us to be tempted above what we're able. People misquote that scripture a lot and say that God won't put no more on you than what you can bear. The scripture does not say that. It says God will not allow you to be tempted. And as Evangelist Sellers already spoke concerning Jesus, God allowed the place of temptation, but God wasn't the one that tempted. The devil is the tempter. So no matter what come in our life, God always have a plan for us to escape. He's always got a plan for us to overcome. So just stay with God. Keep trusting God. And if God gave you a vision, God will fulfill what he said he'll do. So always hold on to God. So God told Joshua, say, Moses is dead. And now I want you to carry the children of Israel over into the promised land. And in verse 3, it says, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given you, as I said unto Moses. Now, the children of Israel, if you read the scripture, you'll find out that they never did claim all the land that God gave them. And this is the caveat. He says, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given you. So the place that they did not put their foot on, they did not accomplish it. So what we have to realize is we got to put our foot on whatever God promises, stand fast, and whatever God has given us, trust God all the way through. And I see that my time is up. So, Evangelist Sellers, I'm going to have to cut this short and just give it back to you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Anderson and Minister Anderson, this morning. I just want to wrap with Joshua 1:5. It says, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. The New King James says, I will not leave you nor forsake you. So thank you so much, Pastor Nathaniel Anderson. We're out of time, but we're excited. Those that are on the call, please do not hang up. We're out of time for today. We'll be back Monday morning live at 5, Lord willing, on Facebook Live. But remember what Pastor Anderson said, God is good, God is faithful, and Lady Anderson said, God is always your best chance of recovery. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5, for every child of God defeats this evil world, and we achieve this victory through our faith. And who can win this battle against the world? Only those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. That's the New Living Translation. But I want to encourage you this morning, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, you already win. You are victorious. Make it personal this morning. Those on the call, remain on the line. Those that on the call and listen on the air, we thank you for tuning in to Command Your Morning.
I've never seen a particle at the end of the rainbow, but I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said you'll perform, may not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I think there's your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I think there's your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I will, yes, I will.
For the last hour, you have been listening to Command Your Morning Prayer Line, live this morning from the Upper Room Ministries, Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, out of Waycross, Georgia, where the pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III, the host of Command Your Mornings now, Monday through Friday, that's 5 a.m. until 6 a.m. This is Evangelist Dr. Renae Sellers. Don't forget to listen online 24/7 at www.foxy97.com. Command Your Morning is a service of the Upper Room Ministries, Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, Waycross, Georgia.
Wait on the Lord. Wait on.